is today a legend of American politics, but John F. Kennedy's campaign to become President of the United States started with a simple speech in the snow in Nashua. His nomination in 1960 was far from a foregone conclusion, but his success in the first in the nation primary was virtually assured, as the Massachusetts senator had been persistent in cultivating the small but passionate core of the Democratic Party here in New Hampshire. Here's a brief clip from Senator Kennedy's speech in front of Nashua City Hall on January 25th, 1960.
And therefore, what we start here in New Hampshire today, I believe must succeed next summer and next November. And therefore, I want to express my appreciation to you and ask you for your support in the primary this March. Thank you very much.
Joining us now for a look back at John F. Kennedy in 1960 is State Senator Lou D'Alessandro of Manchester. Senator, thanks for being with us.
Oh, my pleasure. Always a pleasure to be with you.
And just so viewers have some historical context, long before Gronk donned number 87 for the Pats, there was Senator D'Alessandro wearing number 87 for UNH, dragging tacklers all over the field. That's you right there.
Right.
So that's who you were in 1960.
That's where
you're
I was.
Young, you're Catholic, you're
right.
Building a better life for yourself.
Right.
What did John F. Kennedy mean to a kid from East Boston?
Well, I think he meant everything. He was our congressman, he was our senator, and he was the best thing since sliced bread. I mean, he an attractive man with a real national audience to play to. But indeed, he was a local guy who had come to East Boston, where I was a kid and had campaigned in East Boston. My dad was a little bit involved in politics in those days, not a great deal, but to some extent, and the Kennedy name was magic, no question about that.
He comes to the UNH campus, and you get to meet him in a very unique way. Tell this, this is the great story.
I think it's the most unique thing of all, because in today's world, I probably would have been shot dead. I don't think there's any question about that. The future president came to New Hampshire, UNH, to give a speech. He gave it at New Hampshire Hall. The hall was packed, and I couldn't get in. I go around to the side of the building. I jack open a window. I jump up on the windowsill, and then I jump down onto a stairway, and I land on the stairway, and my head is down. I look up, and there's a hand, and the president says, "Hi, I'm John Kennedy." I said, "Hi, I'm Lou D'Alessandro." So that's how I met John Fitzgerald Kennedy. You know, very brief interlude, "Hi, how you doing," so forth and so on, but that's how I met him. And here are the things that I remember most vividly about John Kennedy. His hair, you know, which was, as it was, sandy, so to speak, but not perfect, but perfect, if you know what I'm saying.
Yeah.
He had a wonderful tan.
Mm-hmm.
He had on a tweed jacket. He was tweedy, no question about that. And had great smile and total control of the situation. I mean, here I am landing in front of him, and what does he do? He puts out his hand and says, "Hi, I'm John Kennedy." Well, I'm Lou D'Alessandro. Nice to meet you.
No surprise for him, basically. He just rolled with it.
Yeah, he rolled with the punch. It was just great. And then he speaks at New Hampshire Hall, gives a speech, and I think excites the crowd, as you know. He's a wonderful speaker, and had great command. His persona gave him great command of the situation. It was something I'll never forget. Obviously, here we are many, many, many years later. He's passed away, and we're there. And I went to his grave after he was assassinated, and I mean the old grave, and I walked across wooden planks and saw his resting place with the caps of the servicemen around and with the eternal flame in the middle. And it was a mess. There was a white picket fence around it. And then I've gone, many times when I go to D.C., I visit his resting place now. And there's no question in my mind that John Kennedy did something that other presidents in my lifetime haven't done. And he gave an aura of excitement, an aura of challenge, and I think created a situation, certainly for me, where I wanted to do something positive for the country. I wanted to become involved, and he was a great, great inspiration. And he, you know, I've met people along the way who said when he walked over to his press conferences in D.C., he would stop in the truck, say hi to the people who were doing it. He had great personal relationships, and came across as just a really down-to-earth guy. I visited the church in Newport where he got married. Went there with my wife on a couple of occasions. So I can tell you, he made a lasting impression on my life, and certainly a lasting impression on this country. Now, there's been a lot said about him, you know, since his assassination. Pluses and minuses, and you know, that is, it is what it is. But the one thing that can never be taken away is the excitement that he projected. That speech, you know, ask not what America can do for you, ask what you can do for America. There's a real challenge. And I think if more politicians today would listen to that speech, we'd be a lot better off in terms of doing things positive for this country.
Mm-hmm. In 1960, for you at least, what set him apart from other candidates? Obviously, he's Catholic and he's got that aura.
Right.
But was there something that set him apart from, say, Lyndon Johnson or the other people who were running for president
that
year?
Yeah, I think so. A, he was young. Mm-hmm. B, he had great charisma. And see, he was not a run-of-the-mill politician at that time. Had this great war record. I mean, that story is just unbelievable, saving his men and so forth. So all of these things combined, you know, made him different and made him special. Big family, big Roman Catholic family, and they all got involved
His Catholicism, a point of pride for Catholics, obviously,
yes,
but a question mark for other people. Did you see any of that anti-Catholic sentiment at all here in New Hampshire back in 1960?
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. Sure. And that anti-Catholic sentiment has been around for New Hampshire since its inception. Remember, we had to change the Constitution to allow for a Roman Catholic to hold public office. I could not be holding public office if our Constitution hadn't been amended. The anti-Catholic sentiment is more pervasive, or was more pervasive, as you moved into the southern part of the country. It's just the way it was. But the white Anglo-Saxon Protestant was very strong in New Hampshire, and still holds a very strong position in New Hampshire. The Episcopal diocese here is quite strong.
Mm-hmm. Any manifestations of that? I mean, that you saw, where people just, it was sort of something that was unspoken, but it was that opposition was just part of it.
Yeah, I think your comment is correct. Unspoken, because people didn't want to be come out as being anti-Catholic. Mm-hmm. They just didn't want to manifest that. But certainly, the underswell was there, and it is there. Why kid ourselves?
Mm. You've seen a lot of candidates in your day.
Yes.
Where does President Kennedy rank, as all of them that you met? Where does he rank in terms of sheer political ability?
Oh, I think in presence, ability to articulate the issue, and an ability to get you excited. You know, he's got to be number one. Clinton is probably, number two. They both could get you excited about something. But the real answer to that is this: will there ever be another John Kennedy? I don't think so. You know, I just don't think so. The world has changed. The world has changed quite dramatically since that time. Remember, he was a television personality. Now, for crying out loud, 24/7 coverage, you died to hear those press conferences. Those press conferences were magnificent. I use them in my class. I teach at St. A's, and I did teach at Franklin Pierce and so forth. But use those press conferences, the anecdotes, his ability to fun with the press.
Right.
All of these interchanges kind of don't exist today, because there's a barrier today, and in many instances it's quite hostile, to be honest with you.
This was a very early primary campaign, sort of in the modern primary, but what did this teach you, or what is the lesson of Kennedy's campaign here in New Hampshire for the wider first-in-the-nation primary?
Oh, the lesson is one that's been around for a long time. If you can't do it in New Hampshire, you can't do it. I mean, it's quite clear. It's one of the few places left where you can actually do people-to-people politics. You can do door-to-door politics. People are very receptive to it here. We still congregate at the local restaurants. We still have breakfast at the Chez Vachon's and the Blake's and so forth, the back room. All of this still exists in New Hampshire, and it doesn't exist many other places. Try this in South Carolina. It ain't going to work. But it does work here, and it catapults you to the point where you can gain viability as a candidate. Jimmy Carter stood on the corner of Bridge and Elm and met people and eventually became President of the United States. You know, there's a lesson to be learned there, a lesson to be learned. And I think New Hampshire has been able to keep this situation alive. How long it's going to remain, I don't know. I really don't know. This is probably, it's the 100th anniversary, but it may be the last time that this is going to happen, possibly.
Senator D'Alessandro, thanks so much for sharing your perspective on 1960.
It's my honor and pleasure to be with you, and 1960 was a great year.
All right. Thanks so much for your time, and thank you for watching this episode of Primary Vault.